second tee, I was gone. See, I was gone.
So that's it. You said at the cross, it is finished. The price is paid. So it's up to you now, the listener. If you believe in your heart and confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord, you shall have eternal life. Thank you so much now for tuning in our program, and God bless you.
This is Spirit FM.
This is Spirit FM.
This is Spirit FM.
Music and ministry to guide your day. WAFG LP, Pompano Beach. In the Word Live, the conversational teaching Bible study of God's living Word with Pastor Ken Carrigan. Ken Carrigan is the founding pastor of Calvary Chapel, Pompano Beach, Florida. Now, here's Pastor Ken Carrigan.
And good evening. We are so glad you're here with us tonight on Spirit FM Radio, 107.1 on your FM dial. Glad to have you with us for In the Word Live tonight. I am Pastor Ron, Associate Pastor at Calvary Chapel, Pompano Beach, sitting in tonight for Pastor Ken, who is still a little bit under the weather tonight, not feeling 100%, so he asked me if I would just sit in and chair the program tonight, so I'm happy to do that, and we have just a great program in the next hour for you. If you're listening tonight, as you're driving on the radio, when you get home, you can listen to it on the internet. You can listen on Alexa. If you have Alexa, just say WAFG. If you would like to watch live video from our studio tonight, you can tune into our video website, which is ccpblive.com. That's ccpblive.com. You can watch live video here from the studio, and you will note that all three of us have faces for radio, not TV. But you can watch us anyways here from our beautiful studio here in Pompano Beach. We had a great day today at Calvary Chapel, Pompano Beach. By the way, Spirit FM Radio is a ministry of Calvary Chapel in Pompano Beach. If you would like to come and visit us, we would love to see you. We meet at 10:15 on Sundays at 201 Northeast 2nd Street in Pompano Beach. That's 201 Northeast 2nd Street in Pompano Beach. That's 10:15 on Sundays, and we meet on Wednesday nights for Bible study at 7 p.m. We have a great time of worship, teaching, and then fellowship. I know I enjoyed the fellowship today because there was some carrot cake there to celebrate my birthday, so it was really nice. I enjoyed that carrot cake, and that was really yummy. So Pastor Ken's wife, Wendy, for getting that. Thank you so much. Just a real quick shout-out to Johnny and Gisela tonight over in Sweden, the pastor of our plant church in Sweden, the Rock Church. They are headed here to see us on Wednesday, so we're praying for your safe travels. It'll be great to see you as you come to visit for a couple weeks and stay with us, actually, at our home. And I'm really looking forward to that, getting to know you guys just a little bit better. So looking forward to that. Thank you to Ryan Wilson, who is behind the window tonight, running the cameras, making sure that we look as good as we can here on the live video. I have two guys with me tonight that it's always a pleasure to have you guys in the studio. You're not really guests anymore because you've been here so many times, and I just appreciate Anthony Acampora. Great to see you tonight. How are you doing?
Doing very well. Thanks, Pastor Ron. And I was saying today when you guys announced birthday cake, I said, dude, I've never seen a birthday cake that I didn't like. So
that's right.
Yeah.
Especially a carrot cake. That's carrot my cake. Favorite. Yeah. So,
but happy birthday.
Thank you so much.
And it was
so
an amazing day today at Calvary Pompano Beach. Just an incredible message and worship.
It was.
1-2 punch there.
It was. Yeah. Great worship. Robert and Lauren and Keith just did a great job leading us into the throne room for our guest speaker this morning, who is sitting right next to you this evening. Pastor Bill Schott from Calvary Chapel, Fort Lauderdale, also CCA, teacher of juniors and seniors of the Bible. How are you tonight?
I'm doing really well. I haven't been here in a month and a half or so, so it's good to be back.
I know. We missed you.
Yeah.
And so it's good to have you. And thank you so much for your teaching this morning. It was just so enlightening. And we're going to talk about that tonight. We have just a great program. As we look at just an overview of the Book of John, you know, we're going through the Book of John here on the radio station on Sunday nights, and we will get back into it. We've missed a couple weeks here, but we're going to get back into it. But the overview that you gave us this morning, Pastor Bill, was just so enlightening. And I'm looking forward to just getting more into that tonight as we just dig a little bit deeper to set up the roadmap as we continue through the Book of John.
Yeah, it's like, you know, first of all, thanks for having me at your church this morning. What a wonderful congregation. And I used to always, every Sunday night, I'd hear you and Ken, you know, invite people to come to the church over the radio waves here. And I just listen and hear how great the service is and the worship. But now I know firsthand it's a real deal church. It's a wonderful place to be. I love stained glass windows. You guys got some of the best going there.
We do.
It's a beautiful sanctuary there. And I highly recommend it to anybody looking for a church. But, so this morning we went through, since Pastor Ken's walking you verse by verse through the Gospel of John, I thought it'd be cool for your congregation to have the overview. And as I told them, it's like a 30,000-foot view of the Gospel of John. Instead of sticking your nose really close in the Bible and reading verses and memorizing verses and seeing it that way, we backed up and we saw the whole thing from chapter 1 to chapter 21, you know, from beginning to end. To see a theme that runs through there. And when you see that theme, it kind of speaks to your soul a little bit. So.
You know, Bill, and what was so interesting about it is that you just didn't look at the Book of John. You were all the way back into the Book of Exodus and really just tying everything together, even in the Book of Genesis when you were that little section that you talked about, and it was really great. So. It was just a wonderful overview, and we're going to get into it. And we'll just start. Let's just kind of start where you kind of started this morning, and we'll just kind of get into it.
Yeah, so I pointed out each of the four Gospels has an underlying theme to it, and I think we miss it because we're kind of trained to, I call it snorkel. We kind of snorkel through the Bible. We put our mask on. We got our little tube for air. But we can only see what we can see from the surface. And we learn the Bible on a surface kind of level. So I encourage us to put on the oxygen tanks and dive deep down and see things you can't see from the surface. And a lot of those are connecting stories, not just from chapter to chapter, as we did in John today, but also from Old Testament to New Testament. John's gospel cannot fully be understood unless you know what's going on in the book of Genesis, Exodus, and Numbers, at the very least. Those are three Old Testament passages I went to show what John was talking about. And it all hinges on, the theme of John hinges largely upon Jesus's claim to be the new temple. He challenged the Pharisees and he said, destroy this temple and I'll rebuild it in 3 days. And of course he was speaking of the temple of his body. So as he speaks of the temple of his body, John actually displays each and every item of the Old Testament tabernacle, the portable temple that they carried through the wilderness with them. He displays Jesus fulfilling each and every item in that tabernacle systematically as he walks you through John's gospel. And then when we get to the very end, which I'm sure we'll get to tonight, it's the most, to me, bone-chilling discovery maybe in the whole Bible is what Mary sees in that tomb when Christ is risen.
I agree. Anthony?
Yeah, the way you were presenting it and just tying everything together, there was actually like audible like gasps a couple of times when we were sitting there, and I was like, whoa, you know, the lady that I was sitting next to that gave you a great shout out. She said it was like the best service she's heard, but it just, you don't think of these things. And like you said, when you're just like looking at it from verse, like just straight up with one verse, you're missing all of this. And there's such a correlation between, you know, the Old Testament and the New Testament, obviously, and it's just so amazing. I brought a guy a couple weeks ago who grew up Jewish, and Pastor Ken was doing something very similar and just tying the Old Testament to the New Testament. And when we talked after, he was like, that was amazing, man. I can't believe I never even thought of it like that, and I was never really taught like that. So it was a real eye-opener today. It was just a blessing to be there.
Pastor Bill, you kind of broke down the tabernacle, the different pieces of the tabernacle, and then went through them piece by piece. Kind of give us that overview here before we go on break here just for a minute.
Yes. So the way I like to present it is with the Old Testament tabernacle, there was one day a year where the high priest would bring a lamb to sacrifice for the forgiveness of Israel's sins. That day of the year was called Yom Kippur, which in Hebrew means Day of Atonement. And the high priest was given very strict instructions on how to go about sacrificing this lamb, because God really and actually dwelt in the Holy of Holies of that tabernacle. His presence is so real that anyone who entered into it in an unprescribed way died. So God was prescribing how he can be approached and so forth. And so only the high priest could do this. He could only do it once a year. And what he would basically do in a nutshell is he would, of course, have to slaughter a lamb, and then he would dip a hyssop branch in its blood, and he would approach this above-ground pool of water called a laver, and he'd wash his hands and feet in that laver before he was allowed to enter into the tabernacle itself. As he entered into the tabernacle, now with the blood of the lamb on the branch, immediately to his right would be a table of showbread, and those 12 loaves of showbread symbolize the fact that through their wilderness wanderings, God would provide for the 12 tribes of Israel manna miraculously morning by morning. So this showbread would remind them, we don't have to eat this. God is providing all the time for us. Immediately to their left, they see this lampstand, this golden lampstand. And God told Moses to make sure that lampstand was lit every night at sundown so that darkness never entered into the tabernacle. And he said it's because there's no darkness in the presence of God. So the tabernacle will be lit by the sun by day and by the lampstand by night. And then the next item would be the altar of incense. And they would burn incense 24/7, nonstop, on this altar, because the smoke that would rise from the incense represented the prayers of the people. And so as God wants us to pray continuously, as we're told in Thessalonians, this smoke represented continuous prayer of the Israelites going up to heaven. And then behind that would be the veil. And the veil is what kept everybody but the high priest out of the Holy of Holies. So the veil was there to keep people out, and the symbol to keep them out were two cherubim, two high-ranking angels were sewn onto each end of the veil that represented the cherubim from the Garden of Eden that kept Adam and Eve out from returning to the garden. So those cherubim would be a visual reminder of them. They can't go behind this veil. Then you would get into what's called the Holy of Holies, which was behind the veil, where the Ark of the Covenant was kept. And the specific instructions for the building of this Ark of the Covenant, the important details for us, are the lid of the Ark of the Covenant, the gold lid, which is known as the mercy seat. And God told Moses on that mercy seat to build two angels made of gold, and to have their wings extended towards each other, facing each other, one at one end of the lid and one at the other end of the lid of the Ark of the Covenant. And they're to be looking down at the lid to serve as two witnesses for what would be sprinkled in between the angels. And that would be the blood of the lamb. The high priest would sprinkle the blood of the lamb in between those two cherubim on the lid of the mercy seat. And that would be the witness that blood was shed for Israel's sins so that they could be forgiven. So as we kind of give that overview of it, we see John in his gospel systematically, chapter by chapter, walking us through the fulfillment of each of those.
And that's just the start of it. So don't go away. We will be right back after a very short break.
Is Spirit FM.
Most of us like to be out in the sun. That's why sunscreen and other safety measures are key to protecting your skin from aging and cancer. The FDA recommends using a sunscreen with a sun protection factor, or SPF, of 15 or higher. Also, look for broad spectrum on the label. That means both harmful ultraviolet A and B rays are blocked. UVA rays age the skin, UVB rays burn, and both cause cancer. But the perfect sunscreen doesn't count if you use it wrong. Don't need sunscreen on a cloudy day? Wrong. 80% of UV rays still get through the haze. Only use sunscreen at the beach? Nope. Anytime you're outside, UV rays attack the skin, so you need protection. And you have to reapply sunscreen every 2 hours. Remember, SPF plus broad spectrum equal healthy fun in the sun. Visit www.fda.gov/sunscreen for more information. A message from the U.S. Food and Drug Administration.
You're listening to the new Spirit FM Music.
Word of God, speak. Would you pour down like rain? Washing my eyes to see.
In ministry.
Trust in the Lord with all thine heart. Lean not unto your own understanding. In all of your ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct your path.
WAFG LP, Pompano Beach. You're listening to In the Word Live on Spirit FM Radio. If you'd like more information on this show, go to our website at spiritfmradio.com. In the Word Live continues now.
And we're back. Thanks for staying with us for this exciting program, because we're looking at a topic tonight that we don't often talk about, but there's just so much to dig into when we look at the book of John and the Old Testament and how it just all links together. And it's such a beautiful picture, and it really helps us to just understand the gospel as we go through it. So, Bill, you were talking about the sacrifice of the lamb. Why don't we pick it up there and share with us that little where we're going for that?
Sure. So I think the best way to understand this gospel, this whole theme throughout the gospel, is to imagine that you're the high priest of Israel. And it's Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement, and you've got to sacrifice the lamb. And let's see all the things that be entailed in you doing this. Well, first thing you're going to need, of course, is a lamb. So what does John start his gospel with? But when he meets Jesus, when John the Baptist first meets Jesus in chapter 1, verse 29, he says, "The next day John saw Jesus coming toward him and said, 'Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world.'" Now, there's all sorts of names for God given in the Old Testament mm-hmm. that the first century Jews would have been familiar with, but John doesn't use any of them. He calls him the Lamb of God. And this, as you said, you know, I tied in Genesis with this. There was a long overdue expectation from Genesis 22 onward, where Abraham goes to sacrifice his son Isaac, and as Isaac realizes there's a sacrifice that's going to happen, he tells his dad, "Hey, I see the wood and the fire for the sacrifice, but where's the lamb?" He knows what's prescribed. He knows a lamb should be there. But Abraham says something very prophetic. He says, "God will provide himself the lamb." Now, there's the prophecy of expect a lamb to come that God will provide. But when the angel holds Abraham's arm back and says he doesn't have to sacrifice Isaac, he provides instead a ram that was caught in the thickets. And what I didn't mention at church this morning that's pretty cool about this is the thickets is the thorn bush. So it's a ram that's caught in thorns, just like our Savior will be caught in thorns on his head one day. But because it was a ram and not the prescribed lamb, it left the Jew asking from Genesis 22 all the way up to the first century when Christ came, where was the lamb for the sacrifice? And that's why John uses the language he does. He satisfies their question and longing for the coming lamb. The fulfillment of Abraham's prophecy, God will provide himself the lamb. Well, when a ram comes, you say, God didn't provide a lamb. He provided a ram, and that's different. But when John introduces Jesus, he tells them to behold. It's the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. So if we were alive in the first century in Israel, we probably would have said, "Ah, there's the lamb. Finally, the lamb has come." So it satisfies their expectations.
You know, and I think that was one of the things that hit me this morning as you were teaching, the verse number 29 in chapter 1.
Yeah.
Of all the names that John could have used.
Yeah.
But what he used was the Lamb of God.
Yeah.
And that just, whoa. I never really thought about that, but that is so true. Anthony, I know you had some thoughts on that too, as we were talking this afternoon.
Yeah, it's just, you know, how specific everything is and the order. You know, we always try to get people to, just look outside, look at the stars, the moon, the sun, the order of everything. And then when you start, you know, digging in today to the word, to the gospel, like today, like Pastor Bill did, and I'm telling you, it's almost like mesmerizing. It's unbelievable the significance of each word and everything that's written. It's just so deep. And it's just unfortunate because sometimes I think what happens is we get busy with life, and I'm guilty of it too, and I'll be doing other things while I'm trying to read the word, or I'm trying to listen to it on Dwell or on an app, and I'm missing it. And I'm like, I didn't really get much out of that, because it's just way too deep to be distracted and try to get this. You have to be completely focused. You have to meditate on the word. You have to picture it. There's so many different things, because it's just so incredibly deep. And that was illustrated tremendously today.
Absolutely. So, Bill, we've talked about the Lamb and how John used the term Lamb of God. Keep going with that, if you would, please.
Sure, yeah. So, and this is a comment on what Anthony just said. I want everybody to know this speaks of inspiration. I mean, John's a fisherman. This is not a Harvard graduate writing this gospel. This is a guy that was rejected from rabbinical training at some point in his childhood, saying, you're not good enough to continue on in your rabbinical training. Go do your father's business type of thing. And so that guy ends up writing this gospel that we're going to see throughout this radio program has layers of depth that Shakespeare would be jealous of. So I want everybody to know it speaks of inspiration, because we're always looking, how do we know Christianity is the right faith and all this? Yeah. This is the stuff where Christianity stands alone. So we have our lamb for the sacrifice. The next thing we need is an altar to lift them up upon. And in John 3, as we go, you know, chapter by chapter through the gospel, in John 3, do we have an altar? Well, it's a beautiful picture that we see in Jesus' conversation with Nicodemus. In chapter 3, verse 14, just for the sake of time, I'll just do the one verse. Jesus says, and as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. So the interesting thing here is, anybody who reads the Bible knows the serpent represents something satanic. Right. It's Satan from Genesis 3. Everything about the serpent has demonic implications to it and so forth. So why in the world is Jesus Christ comparing himself to a serpent? That the same way the serpent did something, I will do something. And the kind of cold truth, kind of the hard truth to swallow on that one is that's how serious our sin is. Our sin is so serious that Romans tells us that Jesus became sin on our behalf. He becomes the serpent figure. He becomes all that the serpent represented. The wages of our sin is death. We get the death penalty for being sinners. Right. And Jesus took that death for us. So the same way Moses had to lift up the serpent in the wilderness, this is Numbers 21, verses 8 and 9 for anybody who wants to look it up. But as they're wandering in the wilderness, through their rebellion, serpents are sent to them and are biting them, and they're dying in the wilderness from these bites. And Moses cries out to God for relief from the serpents. And God, you know, if you just read the Old Testament, you're like, why would God do something so crazy? He says, make a serpent out of bronze, put it on a pole, hold it up. Whoever looks upon the serpent and believes will live. Now Jesus says, just as Moses lifted up the serpent, whoever looks upon me and believes will be healed. Just like whoever looked upon that serpent would be healed. So Jesus takes on the serpent figure of sin and death. And if we look upon him, we'll receive healing from our death. You know, Ron, you're great with going to hospitals and visiting the sick and so forth, and going to convalescent homes and so forth. And everybody wants the pastor to pray for their healing. But the only healing that's promised, I mean, God will do healings here on the earth, but the only healing he guarantees us of, that if you're in Christ Jesus, he will heal you permanently from all sin and death. And you will live forever with him without any disease, sorrow, pain, crying, suffering, anything, for all eternity. Death will be defeated for you. Sometimes he heals you here, just just so you can die again,
right?
Basically, but death is the cure for all disease.
Right.
People don't like to hear that, but it is, because you're thinking that you live eternally, then you get that.
Right, and I think that's so true, Pastor Bill. That people do come to us and say, hey, why wasn't my loved one healed? Well, if they knew Jesus Christ, they were healed on the other side of heaven.
They were healed the way God said he would heal.
That's right.
Yeah.
And it's, my mother-in-law passed away December 31st, and we said goodbye to her. But we know that she walked into heaven rejoicing, more walker, no more hard of hearing, more memory loss, none of that stuff.
Yeah.
She walked in totally healed at that point. God healed her the minute that she passed into heaven. And as believers, that gives us that peace.
Yes.
We saw in our family that a lot of our that they didn't have that peace.
Yeah.
And it's sad because that peace wasn't there.
Yeah.
But for those of us that believe and we know that we're going to see our loved ones again,
it's that
temporary separation that makes it very difficult. Yes, we miss them and it's very difficult. But we know where they're at.
And we know Kobe Bryant grabbed the headlines the last couple of weeks with his death on a couple Sundays ago.
Yeah.
And as I told my students the very next day, we talked about all his NBA championships, all his MVP awards, and even the good guy that he was in the neighborhood. And certainly people are highlighting his relationship with his daughter now and how great that was. But what I pointed out to them was the only thing that mattered, with all his basketball training and everything, all his success, the only thing that matters today is what he said of Jesus Christ.
Yep.
It's the only thing that matters. I told them, you'd rather be a peasant born in India living in the sewers with a knowledge of Jesus Christ than to be Kobe Bryant without.
Yep.
It's, you just have to have that value system, the eternal value system you have to have. Now, thankfully, the word is Kobe had a relationship with the Lord and all of that. So we can rejoice over a great life that he lived and so forth. But you never would substitute his success on earth for a relationship with Christ. And we got to get that.
Right. And as you brought up this morning, Pastor Bill, about Jesus on the cross being that serpent figure as we looked upon him, I'm sure that opened up a lot of eyes this morning. I think a lot of people went, whoa, I never even thought about that.
Yeah.
And that is a picture that we have to think about, that Jesus took that sin upon himself.
Yeah.
And God couldn't even look at him anymore.
He cried out in his forsakenness in that very moment.
Right,
yes.
At that time. So, and Anthony, I know that, you work with a lot of guys in the faith-based at Banyan, and I'm sure that you see a lot of this also, to where you're sharing the gospel with guys that, don't know what that future is.
Yeah, and it's a lifestyle of a lot of death. They're seeing a lot of people die right in front of them just by nature of what they're involved in. And, a lot of them come in with, it's somewhat of a distorted view of God. And it stemmed from, wherever they were taught or whoever they were surrounded with. And what we try to do is break through that and really highlight the teachings of Christ and what he was all about and who he surrounded himself with and all of these different things. And it makes them, that distorted view kind of evaporate.
Yeah.
It just kind of fades away. It's like, wow, I never knew Jesus was about that. I never knew he was looking to forgive me. I didn't know he surrounded himself with people like that. So it changes their whole worldview, really.
Well,
yeah.
And you're doing a wonderful thing there, and it's such a needed ministry to where guys are coming in there, their lives are messed up, and you're giving them that encouragement, that hope that they have. And Pastor Bill, you're doing the same thing with juniors and seniors in high school. You're giving them that hope to where they can carry that out, whether they're going into the workplace or where they're going to college. They have that hope of the word. And then my wife and I do convalescent ministry, and we give that hope to people that are on their final stop. This is it. I mean, they're not going anywhere from here. The next place they're going to go is one of two places.
Yeah.
And as we share the gospel with them. Hey, we're going to take a short break, and we'll be right back with more overview of the book of John. Don't go away. We have a lot of good stuff to talk about yet. Stay with us.
This is Luis Palau, and you're listening to Spirit FM Radio 107.1 FM.
The goal and mission of Spirit FM Radio is to broadcast uplifting Christian music and Bible teaching.
There's no space that His love can't reach. There's no place where we can't find peace.
Providing you guidance and hope for every day. Spirit FM daily programming includes great Bible teachers like Pastor Ken Carrigan with In the Word Live from Calvary Chapel, Pompano Beach, along with many other teachers from across the country.
Take me in like an orphan child.
Also, the music we play is prayerfully selected to be uplifting and encouraging to you. Psalm 119, verse 105 is our guide, which says, "Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path." We use this verse as our standard for all the music and teaching programs we air. Thank you for listening to and prayerfully supporting Spirit FM, where music and ministry guide your day.
Hi, this is Pastor Ken Carrigan, and you're listening to Spirit FM.
This is Spirit FM.
This is Spirit FM Radio.
WAFG LP, Pompano Beach.
Many medicines used to treat colds and flu contain acetaminophen, a pain reliever and fever reducer found in hundreds of over-the-counter and prescription medicines. But taking too much or more than one medication containing acetaminophen per day can damage your liver. So always read the label and don't take acetaminophen if you drink three or more alcoholic drinks every day. To learn more, visit fda.gov/OTC pain info. A message from the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services Food and Drug Administration.
You're listening to the new Spirit FM music.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound.
In ministry.
Do you believe that God loves you that much, that He wants the best for you, the best for you, and that your life is for a plan and a purpose? Amazing stuff.
WAFG LP, Pompano Beach, Spirit FM.
Here's farmer and businessman James Wood.
We farm about 3,500 acres. There's pipelines everywhere. The contractor working on my property did not have the lines located before he began work, and it resulted on a strike on a natural gas pipeline. Fortunately, no one was hurt, but it could have been much worse.
Never assume the location or depth of underground lines. Always call 811 or visit clickbeforeyoudig.com before you start work. A message from the Pipeline Operators for Ag Safety Campaign.
You're listening to In the Word Live. You can watch us live from our studio on Facebook, Spirit FM Radio WAFG. That's on Facebook at Spirit FM Radio WAFG.
And we're back. Thanks for staying with us here on In the Word Live, SpiritFMRadio.com, 107.1. We're so glad you're with us tonight. And if you'd like to check out our church and see what we're all about, you can visit us on the webpage, which is CalvaryPB.com. That's Calvary, the letter P, the letter B.com. You can find out all about our church there and listen to past sermons, and we have just a lot of good information there. Pastor Bill, let's continue on. Yes, we have a lot yet to cover.
All right, so we have our lamb for the sacrifice, John 1. We have the altar in which He's lifted up, John 3. The next thing you would come across before you entered into the tabernacle is the laver. The laver is an above-ground pool of water to wash the priest's hands and feet before he goes into the tabernacle. And in John 4 and in John 5, there's simply stories of washing, regeneration. There's the woman at the well. There's she gets transformed from a woman that married and divorced five times, currently living out of wedlock with a sixth man. And by the end of the chapter at that well, she becomes the bride of Christ. The next chapter, chapter 5, a man gets healed at the pool of Bethesda. So it's all fulfilling. It's water stories fulfilling the cleansing that the laver did for the priest there. And then after the laver, you walk into the tabernacle, and the first thing you come across is the table of showbread. The table of showbread had 12 loaves of bread on it that were not to be eaten. They represented the 12 tribes of Israel, but they were there on display just to remind them that God was feeding them manna every day for 40 years in the wilderness, and the bread reminded them that that God would provide bread for them. So in John chapter 6, John shows the fulfillment of that in Jesus as He feeds the 5,000. And the great detail at the end of that story is he tells them to gather the fragments. And as they gather the fragments, there's no fish left over. It's only bread. And it happens to be 12 baskets of bread. Those 12 baskets are now for the 12 apostles, who, according to Revelation, are the New Testament version of the 12 tribes. So as the 12 tribes each had a loaf of bread on the table of showbread for them, now the apostles have their new covenant table of showbread. These 12 baskets of bread show the fulfillment of that. Then after the table of showbread, we'd come across the lampstand. The lampstand, God told Moses to light it every evening so that it would burn brightly throughout the night until the sun came up. And the reason for that was to display that there is no darkness in the presence of God. So therefore, there shouldn't be any darkness in his tabernacle. So they would light that every night. And the fulfillment of that we see in John 8 in a wonderful way. Verse 12, Jesus announces that he is the light of the world, that he's the light of the world. And then in John 9, because there's no darkness in the presence of God, you will see that every time Jesus encounters a blind man who's walking in darkness, that darkness is not allowed in God's presence. What does he do? He gives him sight. He brings him to the light. He'll bring light to these blind people's eyes. And it's a glorious thing. So he fulfills the lampstand those ways. And we're going to go kind of quick until we get to the end, because the end is where we want to spend our time.
Right.
And the next thing we come across before we get to the veil is the altar of incense. And as I said earlier, there was smoke rising from that altar of incense 24/7 to represent the prayers of the people. And in John chapter 17, we see Jesus' remarkable prayer. And I don't know if people will hate that I say this or love that I say this, but either way, we learn the Lord's Prayer. We're all taught the Lord's Prayer. But if you look at that prayer, it starts with the apostle saying, teach us to pray.
Mm-hmm.
And Jesus says, when you pray, pray this way.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the apostle's prayer, disciples' prayer. That's our prayer. We were taught to pray that way. I think the true Lord's Prayer is John 17, where Jesus indeed prays. The entire chapter is Jesus' high priestly prayer. And there he breaks that prayer into three wonderful segments. First segment, he prays for himself. Second segment, he prays for his 12. And the third segment, he prays for all who will believe based on the testimony of the 12. And as I pointed out this morning, they didn't even have a testimony in John 17.
Right.
They didn't even know what was going on.
Right.
Jesus hadn't been arrested, killed, risen, nothing. But Jesus already knows all that will happen. He already knows the apostles will believe because of it. And he also knows that they will spend the rest of their lives traveling the world telling the story.
And that's an exciting point right there, Pastor Bill, is that Jesus knew the whole thing. He saw that whole parade. And we just see that little thing right in front of us.
Yes.
But that we can know that he loves us so much that he knew that, you know, he was going to be the eternal life. I love that that verse, though, where he says, I am the light of the world. And that's so important for us to remember, that he is the light of the world.
Yeah.
Light of the world. I mean, no darkness. And that, when you talked about the lampstand this morning, that was, wow, light bulb went off for me. That's because he's the light of the world.
Yeah.
And there is no darkness.
Yeah.
He can't live in darkness.
Yeah.
Darkness flees, we're said. And that's just such a beautiful picture.
It's the very first chapter of this gospel. It says he was the light and he came to the darkness, and darkness did not comprehend it. So
right.
There's people in the dark that just don't get it. They don't get Jesus.
And you know, Anthony, I know that when you're dealing with guys that are walking in darkness, you're bringing that gospel of the light to them. So important.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, that's basically what it is. I mean, they're going from one camp to another camp. I always say this, it's like if you were in a gang, if you're in the Crips, and all of a sudden you're going into the Bloods. But this is spiritual, and this is, you know, this is on a universal level. They're walking with the devil. They were doing the works of the devil, and now all of a sudden they're coming out of darkness into the light. And it's an amazing thing to witness, and it's an amazing thing for them to see.
Right.
And it's the Holy Spirit that's doing the transformation of the heart. It's not me. It's not anybody on our staff. It's God that's doing that. So it's I have a front row seat to this every day, and it's an amazing thing.
Amazing. Bill, continue on.
So we've had If you're the high priest, you would first need a lamb, and we get that in John 1. You'd need to lift him up on an altar. We had that in John 3. You need to wash in the laver. We had that in John 4 and 5. You would walk past the table of showbread. We had that in John 6. You'd come across the lampstand. We had that in John 8 and 9. You'd come across the altar of incense. We had that in John 17. And as I said this morning, I never found a fulfillment for the veil in John's gospel. And so we're going to cheat a little bit. We're going to go to the book of Hebrews because, as you saw this morning, there's an unquestioned fulfillment of the veil spelled out by the writer of Hebrews beyond any question. He says, and it's verse 19 and 20, and there he says, "Therefore, brethren, having boldness to enter the Holy of Holies," that's what we're talking about now behind the veil, "by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way which he consecrated for us through the veil," and here's the interpretation, "which is his flesh." So it says the flesh of Christ is what that veil represented. So when Jesus' flesh is broken on that cross, what happens to that veil? It gets torn in two from top to bottom. So it's that tearing of that veil is representing the broken body of Jesus. The veil is what kept us from God's presence. That barrier between us and God is now broken in Christ. And so the writer of Hebrews invites us to enter boldly in. What a great work Jesus did on that cross.
And as you brought that out this morning, Pastor Bill, that Jesus' body was so beaten, he was beaten beyond recognition almost. And that veil was torn so that we have access now to the Holy of Holies.
Yeah, I would encourage people to read Isaiah 53 and pay attention to the pronouns. I know it doesn't sound like a lot of fun on a Sunday night, but read Isaiah 53, pay attention to the pronouns, because every pronoun that refers to us is glorious, and every pronoun that refers to Jesus is horrible. He bore our sins. He carried our iniquities. Everything that has to do with what he's doing is something of suffering. Everything pronoun that goes to us is to be relieved of suffering. So you get a great picture of exactly what's going on the cross. 800 years before it happens, Isaiah writes it in detail. And again, I'd say there's no world religion that can do that except for ours. So it's one of the great apologetics.
Right.
But
And just to finish up, because we're going to take a short break here real quick, and then we're going to come back and finish this up, because I know you have a really special ending to your teaching.
Well, John does.
Well, John does.
I'm just going to read it.
But you're going to read it, but you're going to teach us what that ending is in just a minute. But as we think about that, you know, I think that so often we forget about what Jesus did for us on the cross, the horrific death that he had on the cross. And if we just take that in and think about it and realize what he did for us, I think we can just experience the love of Jesus in such a different way when we think about that.
Yeah.
And we're going to talk about that more. We'll be right back, and we're going to take just a final short break here before we close out. Hang with us, because Bill's got some really exciting stuff to talk about next.
This is Luis Palau, and you're listening to Spirit FM Radio, 107.1 FM.
The goal and mission of Spirit FM Radio is to broadcast uplifting Christian music and Bible teaching.
There's no space that his love can't reach. There's no place where we can't find peace.
Providing you guidance and hope for every day. Spirit FM daily programming includes great Bible teachers like Pastor Ken Carrigan with In the Word Live from Calvary Chapel, Pompano Beach, along with many other teachers from across the country.
Take me in like an orphan child.
Also, the music we play is prayerfully selected to be uplifting and encouraging to you. Psalm 119, verse 105 is our guide, which says, "Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path." We use this verse as our standard for all the music and teaching programs we air. Thank you for listening to and prayerfully supporting Spirit FM, where music and ministry guide your day.
Hi, this is Pastor Ken Kerrigan, and you're listening to Spirit FM.
This is Spirit FM.
This is Spirit FM Radio.
WAFG LP, Pompano Beach. You're listening to the new Spirit FM Music.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound.
In ministry.
Do you believe that God loves you that much, that he wants the best for you, the best for you, and that your life is for a plan and a purpose? Amazing stuff.
WAFG LP, Pompano Beach, Spirit FM.
Here's farmer and businessman James Wood.
We farm about 3,500 acres. There's pipelines everywhere. The contractor working on my property did not have the lines located before he began work, and it resulted on a strike on a natural gas pipeline. Fortunately, no one was hurt, but it could have been much worse.
Never assume the location or depth of underground lines. Always call 811 or visit clickbeforeyoudig.com before you start work. A message from the Pipeline Operators for Ag Safety Campaign.
You're listening to In the Word Live. You can watch us live from our studio on Facebook, Spirit FM Radio WAFG. That's on Facebook at Spirit FM Radio WAFG.
And we are back. Thanks again for staying with us here on In the Word Live tonight. Pastor Bill, continue on, please.
Okay. So we've had seven items of the tabernacle. We've seen in order the fulfillment of them through John's gospel. And there's many more details as I gave at church today. This is unfortunately a bit of abbreviated version, but I don't want to abbreviate the very last thing here. So I want to see if we can give it some time. And so if I may, I'm going to read the first 12 verses from John chapter 20, which is the resurrection scene of Jesus Christ. It's the first Easter Sunday morning, and nobody knows at this point that Jesus has risen from the dead. And this is what happens. Verse 1 says, "Now the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb early while it was still dark and saw that the stone had already been taken away from the tomb." Now we're pretty familiar with Mary Magdalene, but if you watch movies or plays, for some reason they always portray her as a harlot. And that may or may not be true. It's not in the Bible. But what I would say is that's being far too kind to Mary. The Bible portrays her as a demoniac. And not just having a demon, but having seven demons. I mean, she's entirely possessed by Satan. She's completely out of her own control, completely controlled by the devil. The epitome of evil in a human form was Mary Magdalene. And then she meets Jesus, and she's brand new. And Jesus teaches those who have been forgiven much, love much. And Mary's been forgiven tons, and she loves tons. And you see her love in this chapter. She saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb, verse 2. She ran and came to Simon Peter and the other disciple whom Jesus loved, that's the Apostle John who wrote this gospel, and said to them, "They've taken away the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they have laid him." Peter therefore went out and the other disciple and were going to the tomb. So they both ran together, and the other disciple outran Peter and came to the tomb first. Now, before I read verse 5, I want to remind everybody that in Exodus chapter 25, when God told Moses to build this tabernacle, when he told him to make the Ark of the Covenant, he told him on the lid of the Ark of the Covenant, you're to have two angels. He said one at the head and one at the foot of the Ark of the Covenant. In between those two angels is where the high priest would sprinkle the blood of the lamb, and the angels would be looking down at that sacrifice to be the two witnesses to say, yes, blood has been shed. And because only the high priest could go back there and only once a year, in any other condition, the person would die, the way Israel knew the sacrifice was accepted was if the priest walked out alive,
right,
basically. So keep all that in mind so you could see the fulfillment here. Verse 5, and Peter stooping down and looking in, and this is John, stooping down and looking in, saw the linen cloth lying there, yet he didn't go in. These are the linen cloths that Nicodemus and Joseph of Arimathea would have wrapped Jesus' body in after the whippings and the spear piercing his heart and the crown of thorns, having his face profusely bleed. He would have been, these rags would have been blood-soaked. Blood-soaked cloths that he was wrapped in is what they see lying there. And then the face cloth that had been around his head, not lying with the linen cloths, but folded together in a place by itself. Then the other disciple came to the tomb first, went in also, and he saw and believed. For as yet they didn't know the scriptures that he must rise again from the dead. Then the disciples went away again into their homes. They see all this and they leave. But Mary can't bring herself to leave. Mary stays. And that's what I love about Mary in the story, is her love for Christ doesn't allow her to leave the scene. It's a love your mother has for you. Mm-hmm. You know, no matter what, she's going to be there. But it says, but Mary stood outside by the tomb weeping. And as she wept, she stooped down and looked into the tomb. And she saw two angels in white sitting, one at the head and the other at the feet where the body of Jesus had lain. Now, that is the exact picture of the mercy seat of the Ark of the Covenant in the Holy of Holies. Two angels, one at the head, one at the feet, with the sprinkled blood of the Lamb in between them. That was what the high priest saw every year when he went into the Holy of Holies. He'd see these two angels. He would sprinkle the blood of the Lamb in between them. He'd walk out alive, showing God accepted the sacrifice. Now you have Mary looking in this tomb, and where the body of Jesus had been laying, she sees two angels, one at the head, one at the feet of where he was laying. And in between these angels is the spilt blood of the Lamb. In between them, she is looking at the Ark of the Covenant. She's looking at the mercy seat. She's seeing a scene that only the high priest of Israel has ever seen before. And she's a former demoniac woman. And John and Peter were there, and they weren't given this privilege. The angels wait till they leave to appear. What a privilege given to women, our scriptures bring here. And this says so much about how we're to understand other people now. And Anthony gets this from working in the rehab industry and all that. But this means you never, ever, ever are hopeless about anybody ever. I don't care who you're thinking of right now. Wayward child, departed husband, whatever the case may be. There is nobody who's hopeless. Why? Because Mary is seeing what only the high priest of Israel has ever seen, and she lives through it. This is a means she's had a priesthood bestowed upon her. Mm-hmm. And Peter, who looked into this tomb and did not see these angels, he understands this. Because in one of the letters he writes in the New Testament, Peter will say, we have all become a royal priesthood. And I think he's thinking of Mary as he pens that. The only way Mary could see what she saw and live is if she became a part of the priesthood. And therefore, it was through her belief that she became that. And therefore, we all have joined that priesthood, which is why the book of Hebrews said we can enter boldly into the throne of grace that only the high priest went into before. So this means everything changes this Easter Sunday morning. Everything, there's nothing that's the same after this. The most defiled woman has become a priest. The most defiled place for the Jew was the tomb. The Old Testament says it's filled with dead men's bones, and it was unclean, and they were to avoid it at all costs. But now Jesus' tomb becomes the Holy of Holies, the most holy place. It's 180 degrees different from what they learned about tombs. Mary's the most defiled woman. She becomes a bride of Christ and a priest. The tomb was the most defiled place. It becomes the Holy of Holies. And that is where, when your body goes into that tomb, you will see Jesus Christ and live and not die from his presence. You will live in his presence because of this. And I have spent a quarter of a century listening to arguments against this Bible, and I have never heard anybody articulate anything that can come close to the overwhelming evidence that this is supernaturally written, that Fisherman John didn't say, I got a great storyline I'm going to write about, and it's going to have all these levels of depth to it that you won't see unless you dive super deep into it. So what I would encourage anybody that's listening right now is notice connections in your Bible. You know, keep things in mind. The Bible's always pointing to itself. It's always showing fulfillment within itself. And to me, only if it's supernatural could it be written this way. 66 books, 40 different authors, written on 3 different continents over 1,400 years' time, and not one contradiction and layers of connection throughout. There is nothing like it on the planet. Be in it every day. Let it change your life. It's the only supernatural thing you will ever lay your hands on. So you might as well lay your hands on it every day.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Bill. You have enlightened us on the Book of John, the overview of the Book of John tonight and today in church. And we were so blessed by that. But, you know, maybe you've tuned in tonight and you're saying, guys, you don't know anything about me and you don't know what I've done. And why would Jesus love me? Well, Anthony, what would you tell somebody like that?
Well, we'd have to go to Romans 10:9. And it says this: if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. If the Lord has knocked on your heart this evening, now is the time to answer the call. Repeat this prayer after me. These are my words, but they are an example for you to pray from your heart. Lord God, I believe that you've died on the cross for my sins, and you rose again on the third day. Forgive me of my sins. Wash me clean, for I've decided this day to follow you, Jesus. I open my heart, and I invite you inside to be my God, to be my Savior, and to be my friend. From this day and forever, I am yours. Help me to follow you each and every day. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Amen. Thank you, Anthony, for praying that prayer. And if you prayed that prayer tonight, we want to rejoice with you, because now that you know, that you know, that you know, you're going to spend eternity with Jesus Christ. But what would you tell them to do? First thing.
Oh, go to a Bible-believing, Bible-teaching church. Doesn't have to be Calvary Pompano, but my goodness, what a great church it is. It could be Calvary Fort Lauderdale is another good one. But anyone that teaches the Bible verse by verse, chapter by chapter, in a truthful way, do that. But don't rely just on your pastor for the Word of God. Be in it every day yourself. Jesus says it's your food. It's your nourishment. I'm sure everybody out there has been faithful to at least 3 square meals today, because you know about nourishment for your physical body. But what about your soul? How's your soul doing? So be in the Bible every day.
Is there a particular book of the Bible you would recommend somebody get started in?
Yeah, I would say, I mean, I love John, but John starts off in kind of a crazy way that could be hard to understand. But Matthew, Mark, and Luke, otherwise, any of those would do just fine. Luke is probably the first one I would mention. But, shameless plug. I teach the Bible Monday nights at 7 o'clock at Calvary Chapel, North Lauderdale. Everybody's welcome there.
Yep.
And if the word's not enough for you, we have cookies as well.
Cookies, wow.
Yes.
But no carrot cake.
No. But now that I saw the effect of carrot cake today, I may have to go with that. Yes. Yeah.
Well, guys, it's been great having you here. And it's always a blessing for me to be able to sit over here and host the show. I don't get to do it very often, but we're praying for Pastor Ken that his body heals from what he's been going through. And I know he's feeling a lot better. He talked to me today, and he's feeling a lot better. And I'm looking forward to seeing him on Wednesday night at church. But it's always such a blessing to have Anthony here on the radio with us. Thank you for being here tonight. We'll be praying for you. You have such an important role in so many lives of men that are coming out of addiction, and you're giving them that hope, that faith-based program at Banyan. Thank you for that.
Thank you,
and
Pastor.
We will pray for you on a regular basis. Pastor Bill, it was great seeing you today at church, and thank you for ministering at our service today, and thank you for all that you do. You know, you have such a great ministry with young people, and that is just so important, because you're starting them on a road that keeps them off the dark road. And I know that students call you on a regular basis, and you're ministering to them, and that's just such an important thing. And I want to say thank you for that, because that's our leaders of tomorrow, and you're doing such a wonderful ministry with them. So thank you for that. Thank you for being here tonight, and we appreciate
Thanks
that.
Thanks for all you do,
thank
Ron.
You. Thank you for that. And if you're here with us tonight, we look forward to you tuning into our radio station throughout the week. We play a lot of wonderful teachers, good music throughout the week, and we would love to have you tune in and listen. Thanks again for listening tonight, and we will see you again next time. Have a wonderful week. God bless you, and we'll see you next time.
You've been listening to In the Word Live with Pastor Ken Carrigan, an outreach ministry of Calvary Chapel, Pompano Beach, where Pastor Ken is the senior and founding pastor. Want to come join us on Sundays at 10:15 a.m. for worship, Bible study, and fellowship, or Wednesday nights at 7 p.m. at 201 Northeast 2nd Street, Pompano Beach? You can visit us on the web at calvarypb.com. That's Calvary, the letter P, B.com. That's Calvary, the letters PB.com. For more information, we'll study God's living word next time with you here on In the Word Live.